All right, joining us this morning, we have political analyst Dindo Manjit. Dindo, welcome back to the show.
Good morning, Karen.
All right, let's start first with presumptive President Marcos's cabinet, how important this is. And to be fair to him, the very first day that he faced the press, he did say whether sinuportahan ako or lumaban sa akin, as long as that person is capable and can serve, they are open. They are looking beyond political colors. And yet, it's taking longer than usual compared to past presidents.
I think you have to accept the reality that it's just a week after the election. Mm-mm. And I think we should allow the incoming administration to really build on the cabinet that they'd like to form. And I just hope that it's really based on the unity message that they've spoken about, that it could be a broad coalition of Filipinos willing to serve government in the next 6 years, helping the incoming administration of presumptive President Marcos Jr. to build an agenda that will address the basic concerns of the Filipino people.
Yeah, but do you think, Dindo, that technocrats and even politicians who have lost can look beyond not just the elections, but even the history that Mr. Marcos carries? Some consider it his baggage, because clearly he has repeatedly said that he wants to not fail the Filipino people, the 31 million who voted for him. Do you believe that people would look beyond that, those that he wants to appoint?
I think at the end of the day, we see a legitimate results of the election. We've seen the popular support for former Senator Marcos, presumptive president, as you've said. So what we need to build on is that if we can build, again, a government, I emphasize a government because it's reflective of cabinet, appointments, all over agencies, different agencies of government, to help him address and come up with a strong agenda, because that has been a concern really about his candidacy. They had a strong message of unity. It worked, brought about that strong support from the public. Mm. Now, transform that legitimate support, popular support from the public, into a government that is formed by technocrats. Mm. With those who lost, I'll set them aside. It's something that maybe we can deal with a year from now. But right now is what is critical, is forming a government. He will be inheriting a government that has been challenged. The things I'm talking about, the whole of government, challenged with debt, challenged with the demand of the Filipino people to address what I consider economic consequences of this pandemic. Mm. So we need really technocrats. We need people who are qualified on one hand, not political in nature, because you will need to make decisions which is not political. Mm. As I've said always in my classes through the years, elections are over, governing is different from election. Yeah. So it's now about governing.
What do you make, Dindo, of his first appointee? His first appointment was that
I see value to the two. In the case of Vice President candidate and presumptive vice president, Sara Duterte, people don't realize that mayors are actually experienced in running educational system at a very local level. Mm-mm. Because they run the local school board. In my experience of understanding the structure of public education in the Philippines is that you need to work with local, because that's where the front line is. So if she can bring her experience as a mayor, work with career officials in the Department of Education,
or experts,
the technical side to the career officials, but on her part, make the Department of Education more responsive to its stakeholders. And the stakeholders are the students, the parents, the teachers. Bring that little politics there, and maybe it will work. On the part of outgoing or former MNDA general or chairperson Benar Avalos, I think maybe it's time to put a mayor to run our DILG. so we can truly experience local autonomy. Because that's the irony of the Department of Local Government. You need to empower our local government units, and maybe the experience and the understanding of the challenges of running local units can be brought by former chairman, former mayor Benar Abalos to the position.
Okay. What do you make of the possibility of appointing relatives in certain posts? Although it's quite clear in the Constitution at one point, Mr. Marcos said, e paano kung qualified at competent at gustong manilbihan?
There is a law that prohibits relatives, but there's also a law that allows relatives. It goes beyond what people misunderstand.
Okay, let's talk about that. Go ahead, yeah.
Third degree means first cousin. You cannot appoint anyone who is as close to you. But beyond the first cousin, of course, in the Philippines, we call them second cousins. If they are qualified, if they bring to that position technocratic values, understanding of key issues, we have to set aside the relation and work on the idea that this person brings something, a strategic value, a competent value. But again, it should be within the limits of the law. Because at the end of the day, we want a Philippines that is governed by the laws that has been passed by Congress for the years.
All right. How important is the Senate presidency? Because we're already seeing the lower house. It's already shaping up to, I mean, most likely it will be Congressman Martin Romualdez, right? So clearly he would have a speaker that fully supports him. Not just a strong ally, but even to some degree, a relative. But to be fair to Mr. Romualdez, he's really made inroads in the lower house on his own, won over his colleagues on his own, even prior to the Marcos incoming presidency. But the Senate presidency is a whole other matter. You have names, for example, like Cynthia Villar, who is a powerhouse on her own. How important is the Senate presidency for his success?
I agree with you first, and I would like to share that, you know, Martin Romualdez has to be seen not as a relative of Mr. Marcos, because he nearly, and I believe he had the numbers to become Senate president. House Speaker, sorry about that.
Yes.
House Speaker. And he has built a coalition himself there.
Yes.
So it was not surprising that he would aspire, and I think he would successfully build a coalition to push the agenda of the incoming government. On the part of the Senate, you know, we used to say that these are 24 individuals elected nationally. We create this idea of ambitions also. So what you need to do there is that I hope we can respect the independence of the Senate in the sense that the Senate is seen as that body within our Constitution that puts the idea of national point of view, national perspective. So I'd rather have a coalition of senators built around the idea that they can support the agenda of incoming President Marcos. But on one hand, you'll see a Senate leadership building a coalition of varying political interests, political forces. The one that builds that for me is better.
Okay.
That means you can cut across the political aisle and give key committees that can create independence on one hand, but can create a support for that agenda that we need to address the challenges that we're facing post June 30.
Yeah. And we're already hearing now, I'm personally hearing lobbying from specific or certain senators already ensuring that the incoming senators vote for them as Senate president. But a former Senate president, Franklin Drilon, he was Senate president at one point, said it's important to get a consensus builder and who knows the rules, one who knows the rules quite well. Now, you're seeing many faces, there are many names floating around. How crucial is that post?
The outgoing, I'll relate it to the outgoing Senate President, Tito Soto. The strength has always been he's a consensus builder and worked with the different competence capacities of senators. That's why we saw a very productive Senate that really shaped key legislation that opened up our economy, that dealt with Bayanihan 1, Bayanihan 2 to address the pandemic. It takes that consensus builder. And I agree with Senator, outgoing Senate Minority Floor Leader. You need that Senate President to work with a Senate minority. You need that Senate President to build allies that will have key posts that we need. Mm-hmm. That when I say key posts, critical committees. No? So consensus building is very important. And from that consensus building, I hope that Senate President will have his own Senate agenda, not only follow the agenda of the incoming president, because that's what we want to see.
Yeah.
We want a vibrant democracy in our country, whereby there could still be checks and balance, because that is the way it was envisioned. But on one hand, you want them to be cooperative so we can move our country forward. Because at the end of the day, I always tell, you know, you have to consider, Karen, that our competition is outside our borders.
Yeah.
Our threats, our security threats are outside our borders.
Yeah.
It's time for us to work together. Mm. Elections are over, and let's all move forward.
Mm-mm. Now, let's face it. When under the Duterte administration, he had a supermajority, both in the lower house and even in the Senate, frankly. But then now in the Senate, there's just one lone political candidate, so to speak, and it's Risa Ontiveros. So are you seeing that the Senate might end up to be just another rubber stamp of Malacanang?
I'll just go into looking at contemporary history. Since 1986, with our multi-party system, we have elected senators and members of Congress, actually all in supermajority, from Aquino to President Duterte. They tend to shift and build on either the legitimacy or the popular support for a certain presidential candidate. So this is nothing new.
Mm-mm.
We saw that with Wigberto Tañada. He was a minority floor leader in the Senate. So it depends on Senator Risa if she will be the lone senator minority, or we might be surprised. What about forces like the Duterte forces? What if they create their own bloc?
Yeah, or let's say Jesus Cudero. Or I'm just thinking of right now, certain... Yeah.
So it's not limited to Senator Risa, because at the end of the day, how that senator or that group of senator positions itself and looks at its role in the next 3 years.
Yeah.
That will dictate really how they... We will see how it evolves, the idea of Senate minority, because it's possible that there will be movements that might surprise us.
Okay.
Because Senator Risa was able to work with some of the senators. The Subiri, Senator Poe, they were working, and we have seen how
or
they have
also
operated.
Quite interesting is where would Alan Cayetano, Pia Cayetano, where would they go? They supported, am I right? Right? Mr. Cayetano supported the candidacy of Isko Moreno. That's correct?
Not openly. That was not clear.
Okay.
I think they focus on their senatorial campaign. So for me, again, that creates flexibility on the part of the different senators. Will they build a block that will give us a super majority, or will they give a block that they build up? When I say build a block, a group of senators, 5, 6, 7 of them, creating a minority, but still contributing to the works of the Senate. There's collegiality at the end of the day in the Senate, that you are assigned a certain committee, you work on it, then we'll see how the plenary, that means collectively, how they will work together.
Okay, but then what's clearly different now, I mean, we've seen things time and again in different administrations, but relatives in the Senate, I think, have come to a point that it's just very difficult to ignore. So meron ka ng mag-ina, may magkakapatid. So right now you'll have Cynthia and Mark, which would mean mother and son. You'll have JV and Jingoy brothers, Alan and Pia siblings. And am I missing so far? No, because Jojo Binay did not make it. That would have been father and daughter. At some point, Dindo, what can be done? I mean, clearly, yes, they are elected into office, so it gives you that facade of democracy. But then if you are a family name with a current system that's been in politics for so long, you'd have a head start over everybody else.
It reminds me of an advocacy that I was doing more than 2 decades ago. You need political party reforms. You need to put principles, ideology in political parties, and simply not a tool for personality and popularity-driven politics. Mm-mm. Because as we have seen the world, it has evolved really, especially with media, both mainstream and social media, that a popularity and personality-driven political environment creates Mm-mm. this dilemma that you were saying.
Okay. My last question,
so
Dindo.
We need to build on that. How do we reform our own electoral system, that there will be other groups who can enter the political arena, especially at the national level? Mm.
All right. Dindo, what would you want to see Mr. Marcos do in the next few days to ease investor anxiety?
When you hear of uncertainty, it's simply reflective of an environment whereby people are really at a loss. What is the future? What is the agenda? The main message of unity has worked for a campaign. Can we build on that unity now and form a government? And the best way to do that is form a government that reflects not the political coalition, but reflects the best, most able, most competent people to play a role in key cabinet positions. And from those key cabinet positions, let's reward people with the opportunity to serve government, create that environment where people are ready to serve, and as I've said, remind ourselves that the competition is outside. How do we compete with our neighbors? Yeah. How do we protect our national interests against our neighbors? So let's work together as a Filipino nation.
On that note, thank you so much, Mr. Manhit, for joining me this morning. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.